Issue 4, Georgia's Senate races.
On January 5th, Georgia will hold two runoff races for the U.S. Senate. The stakes are high. If Democrats can secure both seats, they'll control the White House, the House of Representatives, and the Senate. That will allow Joe Biden to pass legislation without GOP support. The polls are tight, and President Trump is back on the trail. Here's what he had to say at a Georgia rally last weekend.
I used to say, without borders, we don't have a country. I can say also, without an honest voting system, without an electoral process that works and that's honest and fair, we don't have a country either. We need to check every single signature in the presidential and senatorial elections. And right now, we have to get out to vote for David Perdue and Kelly Loeffler to show the radical left that we will never surrender. We will only win. We're going to win. We always win. Somehow we find a way to win.
Rachel, we were discussing earlier in the show the idea of shifting demographics. Certainly, we would think that that perhaps helped Joe Biden secure the Georgia victory. But what do you think will happen in these two very important Senate races?
Well, I think they're extremely close. And, you know, when we talk about sort of the cases the Trump campaign is pursuing on voter fraud, one they recently filed in Georgia showed 66,000 underage voters voted in the presidential election. I worry if that's not addressed, this election could go the wrong way. As it stands, I do think Republicans will eke it out, but the stakes could not be higher. This is going to be a $1 billion Senate race, and I'm not comfortable predicting it one way or the other. I hope the Republicans take it. I'm cautiously optimistic, but it's going to be tight.
Okay, Clarence, your thoughts on these races?
Well, indeed, I think, frankly, that as much as everybody wants both of the Democratic candidates to win, it's going to be a long shot. And chances are, well, it's going to be very much of a long shot. The weird thing is that you've got Republicans who fear there won't be a big enough turnout because a lot of folks are going to hear Donald Trump saying it's all rigged, so why bother to go out of your way in a rigged election? And Democrats, very similarly, thought the big battle was over once Trump was beat and that there's nothing really to fight for this time. So both sides have got to work really hard to get out the vote.
Pat?
Well, I think I tend to agree with what's been said. I think it's probably going to be close. I did see that Senator Loeffler, in a number of polls, was behind before her debate, which I watched, which was not a decorous affair, but it seemed like she did more damage to him than the reverse. And so I think if I had to predict right now, I would say that I think Loeffler rose in the polls after that debate.
Eleanor, your thoughts?
No Democrat has ever won a runoff in Georgia. That runoff rule was put in place in the 60s specifically to ensure white statewide winners. I mean, it's a racist rule. So this is an uphill climb for the Democrats. I would point out that Mitch McConnell has finally softened and seems to be leaning towards the passage of some COVID relief before the Congress goes home for the holidays. And the reason he's doing that is because he's worried about the Georgia races and he doesn't want to send Loeffler and Perdue back to the campaign trail without having a little gift from Congress. So I think there's some things in play here. And if the Democrats win, it would be significant, and it would be the first time ever in that.
All right. Before we shift to a slightly different subject, let's have a little round robin exit question on this issue. Panelist predictions on what the outcome will be. I'm going to say 1-1, one Republican victory in that Georgia race, or the two Georgia races, and one Democratic. Pat, your thoughts?
You're close, Tom. It's 2-0.
Okay, Eleanor.
I think it's two either way. I don't see people splitting their ticket. And frankly, I haven't seen any polling. I mean, I'll predict my heart, and that's the Democrats win. But that's not based on any evidence at all.
Okay, Rachel.
Republicans take it, both seats. I'm going bullish.
Okay, Clarence.
Well, the polling I've seen indicates there's not a player. You couldn't slip a playing card in between these two as far as the numbers go. So I would go with the conventional wisdom and say the Republicans are going to take it. But the Democrats in Georgia have been making surprising advances here in recent years, especially with Stacey Abrams' get out the vote drive, this sort of thing. So it's possible I could be surprised.
All right. So, Clarence, another story this week which has been interesting is the idea of the Supreme Court really showing quite obvious disinterest in entertaining some of President Trump's legal challenges. We will see, obviously, what happens in the coming weeks. But do you think here there perhaps is a measure of repudiation due to some of the Democrats who were suggesting that Amy Coney Barrett would shift the Supreme Court into some kind of bastion of extreme conservatism and Trump deference?
Well, I'd say Amy Coney Barrett's participation in this decision would be a kind of repudiation that Democrats should appreciate, because she's not the knee-jerk conservative so many people thought she might be. I never thought she was a knee-jerk conservative. Same thing with Chief Justice Roberts, who obviously has shown once again, he's a thoughtful man, a pragmatic man who cares about the law, and he certainly cares about being accused of being a partisan justice, or his whole court being partisan, left or right. And President Trump really didn't give his own legal team or the Supreme Court much to chew on here as far as a case to be made. He just simply says it's rigged, it's rigged, it's rigged, but doesn't make a case to show that it is. And so what are good justices to do? Even his own lawyers have got better sense than to go and make his claims in court under oath, because they know they aren't true.
Rachel?
Twitter was lying to me about Amy Coney Barrett. I'm very disappointed. I was told she was going to hand this election to President Trump wrapped in a bow. So I think, she is a far more thoughtful than I think a lot of the media gave her credit for. But I think, to the point Clarence made about the president's lawyers, I've been pretty circumspect about a lot of the voter fraud cases the Trump campaign has been trying to bring. I think a lot of them have been a little bit, or a lot, grasping at straws. But I do think the case in Georgia has merit. And I think the best way to, it's not going to overturn any electoral votes, but I think addressing this issue is really important, and giving voters the kind of confidence they want to see in their election requires a careful review of what's been filed. So I'm keeping an eye on that case because I actually think it's pretty substantive.
Eleanor?
I think the votes in Georgia have been counted three times. You mentioned that there's 60,000, did you say?
66.
This is a new case. Where's the evidence? Is anybody arguing it in court? I'm extremely skeptical of claims like that that are tossed out at the last minute without any evidence. They're just, it's
Rachel, do you want to come back?
It's a design to get people aggrieved and to feel that they're somehow the electoral system is cheating them. When in fact, Chris Krebs, who was fired for his statement from the national security perspective, said that this was a free and fair election, and none of the cases that have been brought up have actually, I think one succeeded, and it had nothing to do with the outcome. So, this undermines faith in our government, in our electoral process, in our democracy. I don't see how people can feel comfortable with this.
Let me go to Rachel to respond, and then I'll come to you, Pat.
Well, I actually take the opposite view. I think what undermines faith in the election is dismissing every claim. Like, this is the process at work. I think some of these cases were thrown out because they were without merit. I think that's good. I think the cases that do have merit should go forward. And I think dismissing them out of hand, saying that they're not credible when, we haven't had good reporting on this case in Georgia, it is actually quite sound. That is the process at work. And that gives people faith when the system works. And okay, so Pat. I think building confidence in the democracy requires a court process.
Pat.
Why would an appeal to the Supreme Court by the state attorney generals of 17 states in the state of Texas be some outrageous act that endangers our democracy? That's exactly the way to go. However, with regard to the court now, we've got to look at it and say, first, if they accept cert and they take up the case, when is it going to be heard? Who's going to argue it? And what is the relief that's going to be sought? I saw the other night someone said, well, the relief could perhaps be before the Congress votes for the electoral college numbers, that some of the states could be forced to divide their electors. I think that's ridiculous. The court's not going to do that. The problem is, I think the issue may well be moot before the case arrives.
Yeah, you don't have to read very far into the Constitution to see that there is no constitutional basis for one state suing other states over how they conduct their electoral laws. And
the argument is they've affected the nation and diminished the other voters.
Secondly, you can rest assured the president has asked Ted Cruz to argue the case before the Supreme Court, should the court take it. The court will not take it. I confidently will predict that.
So let's have a little round robin to finish off this topic. President Biden is in office. Republicans control the Senate. A Supreme Court justice either retires or passes. Let's hope it's not that latter one. But a Supreme Court vacancy opens. Round the panel. Does Mitch McConnell give the votes to get someone into that Supreme Court seat? Pat?
We can't. If Joe Biden's going to get his own nominee up there, Mitch can kill the nomination.
Okay, Eleanor.
You know, at best, the Republicans are going to control the Senate 50 by two votes, right?
Exactly. Right, right.
That's a very narrow thing. I don't think Mitch McConnell can stall a presidential appointment for 4 years the way he did Merrick Garland for 13 months. I think the public will rebel. So I think Biden would get somebody through.
Rachel?
Will norms return to the Senate? I think this will require Senate Democrats to make a public pledge that if they ever take power again, they will not nuke the legislative filibuster. But I think until then, until you see Democrats address some of the sort of crazy claims that they were making, I don't think norms come back to the Senate. I wouldn't put it past Mitch McConnell to stonewall this. Although, to Eleanor's point, I think he'd have a hard time maintaining it in the public.
Okay, Clarence?
I think the filibuster is got nothing to do with court appointments, but Mitch McConnell has made it so. And when it comes to taking a pledge to do one thing or another, we've had norms in Congress because we didn't need pledges, or so we thought, that people were going to behave honorably. But Mitch McConnell has already blown the roof off, 13 months to go, and he still wouldn't unfreeze Merrick Garland's appointment. I think there's no limit to what he will do to prevent any more liberals coming onto the court.